When I was ordained bishop in 1998, I was reminded to wear the bishop's color, which is usually a shade of pink all the way to red, to remind that my main ministry now is truth-telling. And the red shirt basically is to show that we are willing to shed our blood for truth-telling, first of all, to Jesus Christ Church and then to the larger community. And so I wear black today to tell you where I'm coming from as a human being. I'd rather be beaten black and blue rather than be stabbed and shed my blood in red. I also will not present a PowerPoint. I'm on sabbatical for PowerPoint. Lately, my presentations have been less of power and no points and has been information overload. But I'm here today to present to you a significant gathering of ideas among the leaders of the World Evangelical Alliance, especially on the commission I'm in, based on the last two gatherings we have in Albania, which was a conference on the suffering church and in Korea last week of February this year. So if I read my paper, it's going to be about 12 minutes. If I do the PowerPoint, it's going to be 30 minutes, so I'm just going to read my paper. Belba Magay, a prominent Filipino theologian and anthropologist and a former president of MICA Challenge, writes, and I quote, "It may startle some to know that the greatest commandment, according to Jesus, is not the Great Commission, but the mandate to love God and neighbor," in Matthew chapter 22, verse 34 to 40. "Many of our enterprises as communities of evangelical faith are centered on evangelism, narrowly understood as proclaiming salvation for the hereafter and getting people to come to our side and believe what we believe. Yet Jesus' understanding of what it means to truly obey God has little to do with getting people to assent to our creeds or such prepositions. To follow God is to love Him with passion, and similarly to love our neighbor with the same care and total attention that we shower ourselves," unquote. In her book, Transforming Society, she further writes that the task of the evangelical church includes both evangelism and social action. "This twofold task is a framework that allows the church to participate in transforming society and defines its engagement in the world, which includes helping individuals change spiritually and meeting obvious physical needs of people in the community. Personal transformation does not automatically result in social change. It is the beginning of it." Magay suggests some approaches to harness the forward movement of individual change, one of which is to build a Christian consensus on which Christian principles become dominant software for national transformation. Her call for orthopraxis, which is doing what is right, and I might add, doing it well, is the call for the church to be immersed in the temporal issues of community to balance the focus on internal things. This, she considers, is the mandate of the church to be eminent and imminent in its perspective. This has been a debate among evangelicals, missiologists, and theologians in the past decades. While it is true that progress had been made, particularly in the last 20 years, led by the European and some North American evangelicals, Asian evangelicals are still struggling the implication of such ecclesiological engagement, namely, to focus equal efforts, time, and resources to evangelism, seeking transformation from personal evil, and to addressing effects of natural and man-made calamities, to issues of global poverty, lack of social peace, lack of national righteousness, lack of public justice, which is seeking transformation from natural and structural evil. Today, my task is to describe the other challenges to global evangelical missions, to provide a different perspective other than from strategy-driven approaches to making disciples of all nations. It is my prayer that this short paper will contribute to a more global perspective of evangelical missions. The World Evangelical Alliance Interfaith and Intrafaith Relations team drafted proposals to study four pressing tasks that may give evangelical missions an alternative perspective in making disciples of nations. These four R want to create an understanding of the baseline of our engagement. The leaders of 600 million evangelicals need to see a fresher look at our terms and differing contexts. We need to have a clear view from which we are coming from. The global evangelical church is expanding in all directions, in warp speed, and the task to help these disciples have a clear understanding of page one of the evangelical faith is great. Two, there is a need to define the evangelical church engagement against the creeping secularism in our more mature congregations, in the public opposition from secular authorities that pose challenges to evangelism. Three, there is a need to deconstruct language of radical Islam to provide an understanding to evangelicals on how to respond historically, holistically, to the effects of this radicalism, such as responding now to the Syrian refugee crisis and other similar humanitarian crises. And lastly, to study the limits and possibilities of religious freedom to give handles to evangelicals being persecuted for their faith. So, number one, to create a baseline understanding of our missiological ecclesiology of engagement. According to the recent WEA statistics presented in the ILF Forum in Seoul, South Korea, in February 29 to March 4 of this year, the evangelical world is now about 620 million. Thomas Schumacher, chair of the Theological Commission of WEA, writes, and I quote, "There are so-called evangelicals who easily forget about our own history. There are so-called evangelicals who are just one generation Christians. There are so-called evangelicals who think that the church, the history of the church starts with them. They do not believe in archives, research, or books with the sources because they do not believe in retrospection. But evangelicals are Bible people, and the Bible teaches us not to forget about our history and to tell others again and again that God did in our lives in the life of our churches," unquote. These 620 million evangelicals are engaged in making disciples of nations, taking the gospel of Jesus Christ in all four directions of the globe in warp speed. And not all are in page one, biblically, theologically, missionally, and ecclesiologically. Most of us are strategy-driven. We have a cacophony of discordant voices dictating direction, content, and method. And usually, the golden rule applies. He who has the gold rules. We need to deepen our understanding of the Bible, and we need to deepen the understanding of context and the gospel bearers and hearers that we may go beyond strategy, those who may become vessels of cultural renewal in the concept of biblical shalom. Number two, to respond to the creeping secularism in the church and to respond to the opposition from secular authorities of the state. The evangelicals need to continually affirm what is to be disciple of Jesus Christ in secular cultures. And this involves engaging the public square in what we believe the Bible says about marriage, family, sex, work ethic, quest for meaning, science, justice, righteousness, economic sufficiency, and social peace. Evangelicals need to preach both inside and outside of the church. Secular societies are increasingly becoming more influential on how evangelicals should interpret and realign their worldviews on issues listed above. It is common now that the civil law of a secular nation, which has an anti-Christianity bias, is used to impose the secular worldview against biblical evangelical worldview under the threat of punishment. It might mean that suffering is the price to pay for global evangelical mission. We must eradicate, however, unnecessary suffering because we lack the understanding of our own biblical worldview on matters that are essential, of wise ways to engage the public square, and of our ignorance of how secular cultures work. Three, to demonstrate the to deconstruct the language of radical Islam. Thomas Schumacher again and his wife Christine of the Theological Commission of WEA published a monograph called Political Islam When Faith Turns Out to Be Politics. And I quote, "Islam is obviously one of the greatest challenges facing the church, society, and political realm today. This challenge arises, for example, in society and politics because Islam exists not only as a religion, it also has numerous rules for coexistence in society. Additionally, it is the opinion of many Muslims, but by no means of all, that Islam also provides the guidelines for an Islamic-based set of public policies and laws. This tack in Islam, political Islam, desires to see sweeping implementation of Muhammad's standards in all areas of life. Islamists believe that they would finally achieve a leading role in the world if they are able to implement Islam historically. This means complete compliance with the Sharia, which is Islamic law applied to marriage and family. This compliance also requires application in the realm of criminal law, which with the Sharia's draconian corporal punishment, unquote. The 20th and the 21st centuries have seen the widespread demonstration of political Islam. It proposes a unity of belief, politics, and social order. In many ways, it has become a pathway to radicalization and jihadism. Then it becomes basically a threat to peace and security in regions where it operates. The evangelical mission's thinking must include the possibility of integration of Muslims in the mainstream society in the spirit of Jeremiah 29, verse 4-8, where the prophet declared to the exiles in Babylon to seek integration and permanence in their lifetime instead of pursuing the illusion of return to homeland within a short period of time. Fourth, to study the limits and possibilities of religious freedom. According to the findings of UN-sponsored regional interfaith dialogue, such as this one in Cebu City in Philippines in 2006, the root causes of religious extremism are often socioeconomic and political in nature. Religious extremism often results in religious persecution. Evangelicals are advocating religious tolerance, which results in more free religious expression. Religious persecution in the Muslim context stems from the demand of the powerful oil-based OIC to the U.S. president in 2012 to ban insults to Islam and a call for more global anti-blasphemy law. It was a call to ban hate speech against Islam. Religious expression with anti-Islam bias are regarded as hate speech, resulting in acts of terror for retaliations, such as the case of the massacre of the staffers of the French broadcast Charlie Hebdo in France in 2015. Anti-blasphemy laws were also used in the persecution of minorities, of women, and the helpless in Afghanistan and Pakistan. One high-profile case was the assassination attempt on Malala, a Pakistani girl who insisted on going to school. She survived the attack and rose to such public prominence that she became a Nobel Prize laureate, and she continued her advocacy with fervor. There are still a number of cases of religious persecution ongoing today, such as the persecution of the Rohingya in Burma, the Romas in Bulgaria, the extermination of Armenians, and the murder of Christians in India. Religious freedom and tolerance advocacy aim to build bridges of understanding towards peace, and the evangelical mission's engagement must employ a deeper meaning and understanding of this bridge building towards peace as against sectarian conversion to our public creeds and modes of spirituality. In conclusion, while our concept of mission is to be agents of God's special grace based on the mandate of the Great Commission, Thomas K. Johnson, senior advisor to the Weah Theological Commission, writes that we are agents of common grace as well. And he says, and I quote, "There can hardly be more pointed and direct call from Jesus to become imitators and participants in God's common grace. He seems to evaluate our claim based on Matthew chapter 25, verse 34 to 40, to be his followers by looking at whether we practice actions that are similar to his Father's common grace. The Father shows common grace to many of his common enemies, made in his own image by giving them rain, sun, and all the things needed for life in this world, including good government. He calls us to imitate, reflect, and image him by helping and taking care of the people made in the image of God. There can hardly be a more powerful motivation to become the giving hands of Jesus in a world filled with suffering, and Jesus calls us to be servants of his common and civilizing grace." The exiles in Babylon were called to a life of engagement in Jeremiah 29, verse 4 to 8. Most deceptive of the depth of their suffering was, most descriptive of the depth of their suffering was Psalms 137, verse 8 to 9, where the psalmist called blessed the one who will pay the Babylonians tit for tat by taking their young and dashing them against the rocks. Yet Jeremiah cautioned the exiles from their tendency to retreat among themselves and engage in tribalism in their grief. Instead, they have to take stock of themselves. When it was God who sent them to exile, it was God who destroyed the most prominent symbol, the temple, what makes a Jew a Jew. And it was God who commanded them to be productive, permanent, and to pray for the shalom of their captors in their prosperity, that Jews will also prosper. The evangelical missions must embody this philosophy in facing these challenges, the lack of descriptive, for the lack of descriptive ecclesiology of engagement. The need to understand secularism, the need to deconstruct the language of radical Islam, and lastly, to advocate for religious freedom. Thank you very much.